Assalamu alaikum. I am Arij Mikati, the Managing Director of Leadership and Culture at Pillars Fund. I am delighted to be your host for this evening's conversation, Connected, Bringing Science to the Masses, with our incredible guest, Latif Nasser. Today's conversation is the season finale of our second season of Pillars Pop-Up Conversations, an ongoing series designed to highlight the ways American Muslims are advancing social change. Every Thursday in October, we gathered on Facebook Live with Muslim activists, storytellers, story changers, and others to learn more about their work and how we can all collectively create change. We encourage you to follow us on social media, tweet using the hashtag PillarsPopups, and of course, post your comments and questions to the Facebook live stream. Before we begin, for those of you who aren't familiar with the Pillars Fund, we are a nonprofit organization and grant maker working to amplify the leadership, narratives, and talents of Muslims in the United States. Pillars is proud to have recently announced our partnership with the prestigious Blacklist on the first ever Muslim List. The Muslim List will highlight the best unproduced scripts written by Muslim writers. Feature film, 1 hour and half hour original pilot submissions will be considered, and scripts from any genre are eligible. Muslim screenwriters can submit original features or pilots until December 4th. And now I am very excited to introduce tonight's events. Our world is a complicated and mysterious place. Latif Nasser has spent his career helping us decode some of these mysteries by making complex scientific processes easy to understand. Latif brings accessible science to audiences across the globe as a co-host of the award-winning New York public radio show, Radiolab, one of my personal favorite podcasts, where he has done stories on everything from snowflake photography to medieval robots to a polar bear who liked to mate with grizzly bears. Earlier this year, he hosted the miniseries, The Other Latif, about his Moroccan namesake who happens to be detainee 244 at Guantanamo Bay. In addition to his work in audio, Latif is the host and executive producer for the Netflix science documentary series, Connected. He has also given 2 TED Talks and written for the Boston Globe Ideas section. He has a PhD from Harvard's History of Science department. Tonight, I'm going to be talking to Latif about how he went from science historian to the star of his own television series, as well as getting his perspective on how science can play a role in how we treat and feel connected to one another. Here's a clip of Latif in action as the host of Netflix's Connected.
Latif, yeah? Welcome in Baudelaire.
Wow, it kind of just looks like everything else.
My name is Latif Nasser. I'm a science reporter.
Oh, wow.
And this is a show about the astonishing connections all around us. Connections between you, me, and our world that'll make you see that world in a whole new way.
Very important question. Does the Queen's poop come through here?
It has a flag on it, so we salute as she comes
through. Okay.
How is the cloud above your head connected to the cloud that stores your data? How can an obscure mathematical law help make sense of your favorite song?
Benford's law.
Could you Benford Beyonce?
If anything does work, then it probably
is Beyonce.
How does the dust of the Sahara Desert nourish the Amazon rainforest?
There's an elevator, right?
I was really excited. We think we understand a lot, but there are so many questions still open.
That is crazy.
A single Google search takes the same amount of energy as a standard LED light bulb on for 3 minutes. That's a mind-blowing. This is a show about our dynamic yet precarious planet. From an electronic country to tiny killers you can see from outer space, shark-proof garden hoses, detecting potential tsunamis.
What we need is nothing short of a global brainstorm.
You just appeared magically. Welcome, Latif. Thanks so much for being here.
Thank you for having me. I'm so flattered. I'm so flattered to be invited.
Oh my gosh, we're so looking forward to this conversation. I, am a not so secret nerd. And I know you're not so secret nerd, so I think we're going to have some not so secret nerdy conversations today. I'm looking forward to it.
Yeah, me too. No, and I really, Arij, I'm so excited to talk to you. And Pillars, I'm like, I'm such a fan. So it's really, yes, it's my honor.
Oh, thank you so much. I mean, Latif, you've had such an extraordinary and unique career. And I'm wondering, just for the folks at home who might not know, what is the difference between a scientist and a science journalist?
Scientist, well, I am not a scientist. Yeah, I feel like I often have to sort of start all kinds of things with a disclaimer about that. But so scientists are the people who actually study the world. They are, you know, the people who spend years and years of their lives to get PhDs, you know, studying some corner of a protein, you know, that nobody's ever heard of. Like, that's a scientist. They're extreme ultra specialists and knowledge makers. I feel like what I do and what a lot of science journalists do is kind of a different thing. I mean, the same way that political journalists cover politics or sports reporters cover sports, we're jumping from here to there. I'm more of a generalist. Some people have beats of specific sciences, but really I get to kind of like read those papers, try to decipher the sciences that they are often written in. But then I get to kind of translate them to the bigger public, but then also kind of like give a bigger picture. Like, what does this mean? Where are we? How does this compute with other things you've maybe heard about in other fields or kind of give my own spin on it. Like, why I think this is actually amazing or actually not amazing, or actually it's just, you know, a hint of things to come, something like that.
Yeah, no, I think that's so beautiful and so evident in your work, like how deeply you appreciate the work of scientists and like uplift and admire what they enable you to interpret, which is so cool. And so I'm curious, like, when did you know that you wanted to become a science journalist? I mean, I don't know anyone who has said, like, I knew from the moment I was born that was what I was meant to do. But what was the moment that you knew it was possible?
Yeah, I don't think I didn't know for a very long time. I didn't know probably until I was sort of in the middle of doing it. I think what happened was I was a grad student. I was studying the history of science. So I wanted to be a historian. I mean, I wanted to be a kind of a knowledge maker in the same way. Like, you want to, as a historian, like, you go out and try to find original things about the past, just like scientists are trying to find original things about the world. And I would just find all these kind of cool stories from history, often about science. And I would just like nerd out about them. I would just like think about them all the time. I would obsess about them. I would like want to find out everything I could about them. And I would like write them up for my friends, and I would write them up and like try to publish them in academic journals. And I just kept getting rejected. And I was like, oh, huh. Well, I had heard, and this is a time when they were still, you know, that there were barely any of them and nobody had heard of them. There was a podcast that I was listening to called Radiolab. And I was like, oh, if I can't publish this thing over here, maybe if I could tell these people and they could do a story about it. I wasn't even thinking that I would do a story about it, but I would start pitching them stories to be like, you should do something on this. You should do something on that. Usually they'd say no. And then the few times when they did say yes, they were like, okay, great. Now you get to do it. And I was like, I don't know. I don't have any experience doing this. I don't know what I'm doing. But then I kind of learned as I went along, and I started making more and more stories for them. And then I also started doing other kinds of journalism. Like, I was writing for the Boston Globe and a bunch of other places, like mostly like just blog posts that nobody was reading. But I was sort of getting the feel of it, getting the muscle, being like, oh, this is nice. And it's nice to like write. It just felt like it chimed more with me to write in this more colloquial, more like unfootnoted way, where it was like, oh, okay, I can just be a little bit sillier and a little bit, have a little bit more fun with it. And yeah, so I just kind of kept, that's then all I wanted to do from then on.
That's an incredible story that you went from, you know, writing stories for your friends to literally becoming the co-host of like one of the premier podcasts out there. I mean, there are probably millions of podcasts at this point.
There are.
One that people listen to, which is pretty amazing.
Yeah, it's I really do feel like, I mean, it's cliche, people say this all the time, but I feel so like I have the dream job. I love what I do, and I get to do it, you know, as much as I want. Like, it's a great feeling, and to be able to kind of have that flexibility, like when you're a historian or a scientist, you kind of have a niche, you have a kind of a beat usually. And sort of academia kind of demands it, or like the structure of labs or whatever else demand it. But the thing I get to do is like, I'm a little bumblebee, like going from flower to flower. Like I get to like go and it's like, ooh, something smells nice over there. Like, let's go over there. Like, so I get to do that. And that's like, for me, that's like, it's liberating. It's tremendously liberating.
Yeah. So, you know, I love that you mentioned that little, you know, metaphor of the bumblebee, because I think, you know, one of my deep core values as a human is curiosity. Like, I'm insatiable about that. And something I deeply admire about your work is your excitement to just really follow your curiosities into completely unknown worlds, whether they're micro worlds or macro worlds. And I'm curious, what is your process for deciding and whittling down which of the curiosities you explore for mass consumption?
Yeah, it's really, so much of it is like just trying to be super attuned to my own kind of very like ebbing and flowing curiosity. Like, so when like an enthusiasm. So like if I keep being excited about something and having more questions about it and wanting to tell all my friends about it and wanting to kind of like call up my parents and tell them about it. And like, if I feel like I just, it's something that is sort of, yeah, it's like kind of burrowed into me. And sometimes that has to do with the fact, like there's so many things that make something sort of shinier. Like it could be that, oh, I like found this great talker, this amazing paleo oceanographer that like that everybody needs to hear. How have people not heard from this person before? Or it's like, oh, this is a very high stakes thing. This is something that everybody's thinking about and talking about right now, but there's an angle on it that like, you know, that I can't believe not everybody is talking about. It's like, it's sort of like kind of being attuned to that enthusiasm, and there's like a kind of a threshold where when it goes over that threshold, it's like, okay, like we got, this has got to be a thing. Like I got to tell the world about this, because how come nobody else is, you know?
Yeah, you know, I think speaking of things that are really important for folks to know, there's that little moment in your trailer where you talk about how every time you complete a Google search, it's like leaving a light on for 3 minutes. And I cannot tell you how much you have truly burdened me with this. I mean, now every time I turn on my computer, I'm just like, what am I even doing here? Like there's no ethical consumption under capitalism. What am I doing?
It's so weird. And that's kind of those are the little nuggets that I really try to find, which are the ones that you're like, how have I been alive this long and I don't know this? Like, it's those kinds of things that you're like, oh, this is this mundane thing that I do all the time. And yet here it is, like here, knowing this one other piece of information, like it makes me reimagine like not just the world, but my very specific place in the world and what I do.
Yeah, no, I hear that. So you work in both radio and more recently in television. What unique value have you found each of those mediums offer?
Oh, they're so different. I mean, like that said, okay, let me start by saying how they're exactly the same, and then right. I'll tell you how they're so different. They're exactly the same because I think in general, there's a thing, and so I actually, in undergrad, I studied playwriting, and I think from there I learned that like, stories are all kind of the same. Like they have like sort of similar shapes and they have like basic ingredients that are the same. There are, you know, sort of protagonists, like heroes that you're following. There are, you know, emotional arcs that people go on. There are, you know, inciting incidents, like I'm walking down the street and then I got hit in the head with a, you know, can of tuna fish or something. And like, so there's certain things that like stories have shapes, and no matter whether you're doing them on the radio or TV or in print or comic book or whatever, like they all kind of work the same way. And like kind of having that, like knowing that makes things actually, like for me at least, it makes things a lot simpler. And it makes me like be like, oh, sure, I'll do a TV thing. Why not? Let me try. But once you get there, what you realize is that is true, that all the things are the same. But TV and radio are actually very, very different. So, for instance, one of the things is like how you talk to people, right? So you do interviews in both. I do a lot of interviews and did for both. In radio, we have a saying, or at least in podcasting, tape is cheap. So what you do is like you just get someone in a studio. Now it's even easier because you do it over Zoom. Like if you get someone and then you just talk to them and you talk to them. Like I do interviews. Our standard interview is 90 minutes and I often go over and you just talk and you're just chatting. And what you want to do is you want someone to sort of like get comfortable with you, feel like they can talk in a way like a, especially when you're talking to scientists, like a lot of them have like very jargony things that they're used to talking in one register and you want them to talk in a different register. So you can kind of like get to know people, get them kind of accustomed, ask questions, let them go on weird tangents and stuff. So you have a lot of time. When I was doing TV, it's kind of exactly the opposite. Like it's like, okay, you're going to meet this person because you're flying in from wherever. You're going to meet this person for the first time. You're going to meet, but the sun is just in the sky for another 15 minutes. And we only have this location for another four. The wind is like, oh, just take a break. Okay, start again. Okay, take a break. It's much more awkward how you relate to people. And also, because there's a camera in their face, and a lot of these people are not sort of people who have been on camera, you know, kind of in this way before. Yeah, they're like super self-conscious. It's really awkward and difficult. So like even just in that simplistic, like there's so many differences, but like even just the way you talk to people, you gotta ask questions in a different way. You gotta warm up people in a different way. You gotta kind of angle yourself in a different way, depending on sort of which medium. There are 100 more differences I could tell you about, but that's probably,
yeah. No, that makes a ton of sense. And I guess my follow-up question is, how am I doing and how awkward am I right now?
It does feel awkward because you're better at my job than I am and you're interviewing me about it.
Stop that.
So that's awkward, but I'll get over it.
Come on. So Latif, you recently premiered a fantastic science documentary series on Netflix, which we saw the trailer for called Connected, The Hidden Science of Everything.
It's a big subtitle, right? They gave me the subtitle. I did not get it. But it's like a good one, but it's like, it's not one you would choose for yourself, you know? Sure.
I feel that. But you know, I think it gets the job done. So science is often seen as this really sterile, objective topic. But your documentary series allows a ton of space for human subjectivity and interpretation. And I'm wondering, can you tell me about how you hold the perceived objectivity of science along with your personal experience of science as you tell stories?
Yeah, I think for me, a lot of it, like, partly is my philosophy, partly is stuff I've sort of imbibed from Radiolab and other places sort of along the way. Like for me, I think so much of the trick to doing that is, and which goes counter to most of the ways we sort of learn about science and talk about science and communicate science in our kind of day-to-day lives, is lead with the question, not the answer, right? Mm-hmm. So I think that, like when you're in high school, like I feel like I have this memory so vividly, like when I was in high school, like they, you know, you're on the first day and then they plunk this physics textbook like on your desk. And it's like to me, what they're saying with that is like, here's a list of answers to questions you didn't even ask. Mm. Like here are some facts about the world that you didn't even ask me for the answers. But you didn't ask me the questions, but I'm gonna give you the answers. And so much of like science, you know, when you read in a newspaper, it's like a headline where it's like, diet soda is bad for you. Like, and it's like, you know, or like, and it, based on this study in three mice or whatever. And so you're like, it just feels like this weird authority. It feels like parental in a way where it's like telling you not to do things you want, or it's like a kind of authority. And then, I don't know, at least maybe in this country, like it feels like it's like, where do you get the authority to do that? Like, it's like kind of that kind of thing. And to me, I think the way instead is to root the whole thing in the question. Like, it's like, start with the question and why it's interesting and why it's worthwhile to look into. And once you do that, then I'm going to follow you wherever you go. And if you kind of say to me, look, like I tried to answer this question. I looked here. I looked there. That didn't work. I tried this. This didn't work. So I came up with this experiment to try my best to try to answer it. And this is what I came up with. And it might not be the final answer, but this is the thing I came up with. And it's really hard. So you're all of a sudden you're getting the personal story of the scientist there. You're getting the kind of like, okay, here's how the sausage gets made a little bit, and not so much that it'll bore people to tears, because a lot of science is very, very meticulous and like niggling in a level of detail that like puts most people off, but like enough that people get a sense, like this is not coming out of nowhere. This is not some arbitrary fickle authority that's telling you not to drink diet soda for no reason. It's like, oh, I'm trying to answer this question that I think is really profound and important and meaningful and high stakes. And here's why. And here's the answer that I came to after all of that work. Like, to me, that's so much, it's kind of like, it's a humbler way of going at it. And it's a more honest way of going at it. And to me, I think it like, yeah. And then all of a sudden, it's not sterile facts that I just have to learn. It's like, oh, that's what, like, we're all on a journey together. None of these are answers. We're all figuring it out together. We're all on the same team, trying to kind of, you know, elucidate this tiny sliver of the, you know, like blank void of knowledge that we all kind of live in together, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. So, you know, I think as the title suggests, a major theme of the series is the idea of connection. And I'm curious, why did you want to center your documentary series on the idea of connection? And how does science make you feel connected?
Yeah. There's a few answers to that. I think one is that it's just fun. Like it's a fun narrative structure in a way to like the way we thought about it always was like hopping from lily pad to lily pad, or I guess to use my older analogy, bumblebee from flower to flower. I mix metaphors constantly. It's really a
great
problem I have. So part of it is just, it's fun. Like it's narratively fun because you never know what the next thing is going to be. And it's, and like, we tried to make it so that like you are in a place and then you never know what the next connection is. And it's like the punchline to a joke. It's always it's surprising, but expected, you know, like, and so that's just a fun structure that I was like, oh, not a lot of things do that structure. But really underneath that also, I think the idea of connection is something that I've seen in so many different fields, like in all the sciences that I've covered, in the history that I've done, like that's what you find. Everything is always more connected than you expect it to be. You go in thinking, you know, we have this idea of us as like individual selves, or we have these ideas of individual countries, or we have these ideas of like, you know, these autonomous units just going around. And then what you realize is like, oh, these are just sort of fictions that we tell ourselves. And that's sort of scientifically, I feel like I've seen that. I've heard scientists say that to me enough times to be like, oh, okay, this is something that feels like it cuts across. And then also, sorry, this is a very long answer, but like, so
I love it. I'm all ears.
There's the kind of narrative part of it. There's the sort of scientific part of it. But then also, I really do think there's a kind of, like almost like an ethical, moral, spiritual dimension to that, that you don't usually see in science programming, right? Where it's like, oh, there is something here that is, it's about science for sure. And that's primarily what it's about. But it also is about who we all are, the societies and world that we all live in, and how we all ought to act to one another. And I think that that's really important. And I think that you can connect all of those things because they like, to me, that's just, to me, that's, I don't know, that's the way that I want to engage with it, because I feel like that's, again, it's more honest, and it's also, I think, I don't know, if I, you know, you work hard on putting a thing out into the world, and it's like, that's the kind of thing I want to put out in the world, something that has a sort of, that has those dimensions to it as well.
Yeah, it definitely comes through, I think, in all of your storytelling. And, you know, I totally agree, could not agree more, that, you know, we're all seeking connection in these different ways, and that spirituality, whatever that means for each of us, is a really big part of how we experience the world, how we study the world. The questions we ask about the world are often very spiritual in nature. Why am I? That's a scientific question that, you know, is going to take me a while to uncover. And you talked a little bit about this, but I'm wondering, is there more that you can tell us about the way your relationship personally with spirituality plays into the ways you approach the series? and how you've seen science and spirituality coexist, because I think that often they're divorced from each other.
For me, one of the ways I think that is kind of a good like encapsulation of that is one of the episodes is about dust. Mm-hmm. And
my mom loved that episode.
Oh yeah. Oh, I'm glad. thank you. That was an episode that so that was the episode we had initially pitched the series on and that Netflix got really excited about and you can kind of see why. Like it's surprising. It's beautiful. Like this dust looks like magic pixie dust, like all over the world, these like NASA cool things. But like while we were making it, a friend of mine, like a very young, a young promising journalist, he just accidentally, through a freak, horrible accident, he died. Mm. And it was like, it was brutal. It was like one of those things that happen in your life that's just so shocking and irrational and difficult. And it was right at the time when we were editing that episode. And it was like, I feel like it was part of it while we were editing it, like it like clicked to me that I was like, oh, this episode is about, it's not about dust. It's not about the Amazon. It's not about the Sahara. It's about life and death. And it's about the ways in which like, this is about the ways in which we kind of leave a thumbprint on the world. Even after we're gone, even if we're gone in a way that is seems, you know, cosmically unfair and really abrupt and like it just was a thing where I was like, oh, that this is a story putatively about, you know, aerosolized grains of Sahara, like in the like flying over the Atlantic, but really it's about life and death. And then when I kind of like clicked into that prism, which was very much like weirdly a therapeutic thing, like a thing that I was very selfishly like kind of thinking about, it felt like it was like, oh, every one of these segments in this episode like snap into that idea, that big kind of a spiritual idea. And so it felt to me that I was like, oh, that's like, yeah, this can be both. This can be a science documentary that is about the facts and it is fact checked and we are not, you know, taking any liberties anywhere. Whereas at the same time, it can have these other registers where it's like, I'm going to speak to something that, yeah, that maybe, most science documentaries, you wouldn't feel these feelings, you know?
Amazing. You know, I'm sure you've thought a lot about this. You dropped this show called Connected that features, you know, multiple connecting flights in like almost every episode, I think.
Yeah, right,
during a global pandemic, when we are completely redefining the ways that we connect with one another and the ways that we're able to physically connect and all of this, emotionally connect, spiritually connect, what was it like to do that during this time?
It's funny, like at the beginning, so when we pitched the thing, I was like, oh, this is such a cool, because there's like a thesis to the show that we're all connected in these subtle, surprising ways. I was like, oh, this is gonna be so great. And then the pandemic came and I was like, this is not surprising at all. Like nobody is gonna wanna watch this. It feels like the idea that we're all subtly connected, like, and I remember this was especially like when we were talking about like, you know, when like everybody was getting like delivery bags and like wiping them down and stuff. And like, and you were thinking like, you were like, oh yes, duh, we're all connected by a virus that's trying to kill us, by like, you know, these, even now, like ventilation systems and, the systems of, like who are the people working in the grocery store and like all these things, like these people we take for granted, these things we, so I was like, oh, this is not, like, this is not surprising. Like I feel like this is the worst timing for this. And then kind of, it took me a while actually to like get up the courage to kind of like rewatch it, to be like, is this worth putting out into the world right now or not? And I think that to me, the thing that, and I guess the feedback that I've gotten from people, like it feels worthwhile in the sense that it's like, oh, it's not just about here are the surprising subtle things that connect us. It's like, here are some of the like poetic and beautiful and meaningful ways that we're all connected, and not just the scary, murderous, you know, like the things that we should all kind of like run under our covers and feel incredibly nervous about. Like, these are also things that we can kind of all sort of take a step back and marvel at and remember. Like, it's like we're all connected in these horrible ways, but in these beautiful, life-affirming ways too. And that it's like kind of a reminder of that at a time when it's really hard to remember that.
Yeah, that really resonates with me, Latif, because I think, you know, as we're all isolated in these like smaller worlds than many of us have the privilege of typically being in, I think it's really easy to lose a sense of wonder. And I think that, you know, what your show offers is this invitation into wonder that I think is incredibly therapeutic. And, you know, even reminds me, like when I look out the window right now and see the trees changing color and, you know, what the weather has been doing differently throughout the entire day. It's been very windy here. It just reminds us to take a step back and find the wonder in everyday experiences that we have. And I think that's so crucial right now.
Yeah. It's a weird time, because it does feel like, I mean, just as a, like, to be totally honest, as a, like I'm a journalist and I do so often these kinds of wondrous stories. And to say like, oh wow, like look at this bird, like this, and it's like at a time when toxic positivity, exactly. Like there are really life and death stakes things going on that are really serious, and that like that people need to kind of sound the alarm about. Among others, like climate change, that, you know, which I'm covering in sort of oblique ways in the piece, but like it is a kind of a weird time to do that. But I do think that there's something. And this is something I struggle with, but I do think that there's a value to be a kind of like that breath of fresh air, like it is a kind of relentless, like the news cycle right now, it's like it's relentless in a way that I think that there is a kind of a mental health benefit. There is a kind of there are other values and the kind of a big picture zoomed out kind of perspective that I think are kind of even juxtaposed next to these, like, you know, screamy headline stories, rightfully screamy headline stories. There's still a place for this, I hope, out in the wider world.
Absolutely. You know, and I think, speaking of the wider world, you kind of referenced this earlier, that a lot of folks in the world that are not themselves scientists can be intimidated by science or even turned off by science. But I think, you know, you have a really incredible gift, which is that you are able to make science accessible to almost anyone, which is amazing. And I'm curious, you know, what does it require to bring science to the masses in that way?
I think I do think that it's not like, I think there's this idea that there are people who are turned off to science, but it doesn't mean that they don't have questions too, I think, you know? And it's like, I think that everybody, like, you just look at any little kid, like they are just filled to the brim with questions. And I think that's all of us. But it's just like, as we grow up, we get better at settling for smaller and smaller answers, or we get better at sort of shushing our inner, you know, dumb question generator. And I think for me, it's like, we all still have it. So it's just about tapping into that thing that we all still have. And I also think that, like, it's about like finding the right, like, and like the thing I was saying before, like lead with the question and find that question and sharpen and whittle that question in a way that you're going to win over the most number of people. Like you start with a thing that you're like, yeah, that's absurd. How is that possible? How is it possible? One of the episodes we start with, this idea that it's like the average cloud weighs as much as a blue whale or something. And it's like, how is it up there? And you're like, okay, yeah, I have that question now. What's the answer? I think it's like finding the right kind of question that will grab someone. And then once it has them, like, it won't really let go of them. And then they're like, okay, I guess I'm along for the ride now. Like, I need to know what, and to me, I think everyone in their way is receptive to that, especially because science, like a lot of the topics that it covers, are so fundamental, right? you know, nature, ourselves, the universe, like these sorts of things. Like, I think that they're broadly appealing, but it's just like giving people an excuse to buy in, giving them just a nudge to remember, oh yeah, I am really interested in this thing. I forgot about that, you know?
Yeah. And you know, the you just said something that I think I'm going to carry with me for a long time, which is that as we get older, we settle for smaller and smaller answers. What do you think it is in you that allows you to not be satisfied with that? Like, that's how can we all bring that to our own lives? Yeah.
That's funny. That's the thing my wife said to me once. And I still think about it all the time, that we, as we get older, we settle for smaller and smaller. We just settle easier for an answer. But I think for me, it's like, I mean, partly because it's now my livelihood, but partly also because it's just like, I think I've, yeah, it's like, I don't know. It's like I've, it's paid off for me so many times in kind of actually helping forge my worldview. It's like, yeah, pay attention to the dumb questions that you ask. Like, and you think maybe that they're dumb, or they're too dumb to answer, or somebody knows the answer somewhere, or Google told me, like, it gave me, like, that's what so often people do. They like Google, right?
Yeah.
On their phone, you know, right? Like, they look up a question, right? They Google, and then there's like a one-line answer that you get from one of the top three hits, and then you're like, okay, that's enough, that satisfies me. And the point is to like push past that, and it's like, oh, but really, but how do they know that, and is that true always, or has that always been true? Like it's like finding the, oh, like, is there a limit case where that's not true, or is there a, you know, like, it's like finding, like, pushing past that and realizing that, again, saying something I already said, but like, what we know is just a tiny fraction of what there is. And yeah, and if you kind of just sort of swerve around what we think we know, like, there's so much more back there, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. And you know, I think one thing I've been wondering a lot about, and I'm wondering if you'll even accept the premise of this question, which excites me. You know, we're living in a time where I have experienced, or I think I perceive, that there is a swath of our population that seems to be actively anti-science.
Yeah.
I don't even know if you agree with that, but if you do, why do you think that is? And what do you think we can do to change that?
I definitely think there's a lot of people that are anti-science. And I think, to me personally, I think that it's that question answer thing. It's like, of course there are people who are going to be anti-science if they feel like you're just bossing them around, and you feel like I remember, when I was a kid, I went to the dentist. And the dentist gave me a toothbrush, right? And it was a hard bristle toothbrush. And then later in my life, I went to the dentist, and the dentist's like, no, hard bristle, you're only supposed to be brushing with the soft bristle toothbrush. And then I like felt so jerked around. Like, I was like, what, like, have I been doing it wrong for like 30 years and you didn't even tell me? Like, what's the point of that? Like, that just feels like a kind of, yeah, I just feel like you're standing here like bullying me into doing something, and I'm doing it, and then I'm doing it wrong. Or like, it's the same thing about diet soda or this thing or that thing.
Yeah.
Like, and vaccines and this and that. Like I think so much of it is like this feeling that science is this arbitrary authority that's pushing on us its agenda. And it's like, and then, you know, and then sometimes it's wrong and they don't even know what they're talking about. Like, and it's like, if you flip it and you're like, look, here's a question that we all, infectious disease, how do we deal with that? Well, you know, and you don't always have time to do that. But like, I think if you lead someone up to the idea that it's like, oh, but look, like, vaccines, like, there's this real big problem that we used to have where our kids would all die. And now, like, a lot less are dying. And I think it's because of this thing. Like, I think there's a better way to kind of, like, a humbler way to do it. And once you do that, then you're more tolerant of the change to be like, oh, it's soft bristles now. Okay, cool. Oh, we learned more. Oh, great. I'm so glad. From now on, my teeth are going to be extra, you know, shiny and clean or whatever, as opposed to, you've been jerking me around this whole time. Like, you know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah. No, I think that's real. Like, the science it kind of seems to be changing all the time. And just like, you know, if you use the diet soda example, there's, you know, one study about sugar that comes out that tells you one thing, and maybe even not years later, 30 years later, like you were saying, but maybe even the same day, a totally contrary study might come out, right? How do you suggest that the average person who doesn't identify as a scientist kind of parse what noise to listen to and what noise is just noise?
Yeah, it's a tricky thing because I do want people to be skeptical about science. Like I really do. I think that that's important and that's healthy. But at the same time, like there are times like right now where we really need to be listening. It's really, really important. And so how do you balance those two things? And like, especially when you have a day job and kids and you have other things where you're like, I don't have time to like look at all the primary sources and stuff here. I think to me, it's like I think part of it is like assume best intent, assume that most of these scientists are not, and which they are definitely not, like making millions of dollars selling you vaccines or whatever.
Yeah.
Like assume the best intent, and try to parse, like kind of genuinely ask questions and kind of, yeah, I think there's look and find journalists who you trust at outlets that you trust. Who you feel like you can really kind of, get the real deal from, you know, and you feel like you can kind of, outsource that work to them, you know, like me or like other scientists. Like right now, I feel that way about there are a bunch of scientists doing COVID coverage, and I'm like, yes, like whatever you say, I'm gonna do because I don't have time to dive into all this stuff myself, but I trust you.
Yeah, that's so important. And I really like the suggestion of even just figuring out a couple people to follow. I think that's something we rarely do when it comes to the way we consume our news. And so I really love that suggestion. And I, you know, to go back to your bumblebee analogy.
Yeah, right.
Let's say I'm a bumblebee, which I am. Let's say I'm a bumblebee and I am really, really interested in flying from flower to flower to investigate my own curiosity. What advice do you have for non-scientists in our audience who might want to be interested in investigating their own curiosities the way you do? I think particularly now in this, you know, time where we're all isolated, we're all looking for something new to do and something new to learn. And I'm curious what advice you would have.
Yeah, I think for me, one thing is and this is a thing I feel like when I was in That's so different. And I give this advice a lot to kids, but it's also for adults, but it especially because it wasn't true when I was a kid, I feel like, which is like, you can contact anybody, like you can email anybody. And a lot of the people I think like, if you have a question, just kind of do some like cursory Googling or do some online digging and figure out like who is the world's authority on this topic, or who is like a professor who I've, you know, heard of who might know something about this, or who is a academic or just any kind of expert. Doesn't even need to be an academic. And just go ask them. It doesn't need to get much more complicated than that. Like, it's like, go look it up, look it up. And if you can't figure it out, like go ask people. And people often are so, especially now in, pandemic times, cause they're often at home and they have nothing better to do. Just actually ask people. And so often, like I feel like, and maybe my, like the fact that I'm a journalist gives me more license to do this than the average person. But students, even just interested people, like don't underestimate how much experts value talking about the things that they love and the things that they study. And just like, they're just waiting there. Also, even more, the people who are waiting there, even more, reference librarians. Go to your local library, talk to the reference librarians. They're literally just sitting by the phone, by the computer, by the whatever, for your questions. And they will help you find where to find your answer. Like those people are invaluable. Like, and they can, especially if you have a question, you don't even know where to start. That's where I start.
Yeah, shout out to librarians. They really hold it down. Seriously.
Totally. I like it's there are these magical gateways to anything you could ever possibly want to know. Like, what? How is that not credible?
Yeah, I miss libraries this time.
Yeah, but they're still doing, like, it's funny, like a little while ago I did cold called basically a reference librarian over Zoom, and then and she was just sitting there with and it's like maybe a very stereotypical librarian kind of a thing, but she had her Zoom background was like the holodeck from Star Trek, and yes. she was just sitting there waiting. There was nobody there, and she was just like, "Oh, can I answer your question?" It felt like it was like an absurd thing, but it's like that's we all have this power. Like, these libraries are open to all of us, even ones sometimes at academic institutions or in countries that you're not in, or in, you know, like at institutions that you've never been a member of or a follower of. Like, a lot of times you just email a reference librarian, and they'll be like, "Oh, great. Yeah, here, let me tell you, like, I'd love to help, you know?"
Yeah, that's beautiful. It's so important to just remind folks, first of all, people might not even know that that's a resource to them. Like, yeah. We have this access. And so I so appreciate bringing this up, because any of us could do this like today.
Easy, yeah.
Which is amazing. So I just have two more questions for you before I'm gonna open it up to audience questions. So
Great. This
is the audience's reminder to put their juicy questions in the comments. But I'd love to know, Latif, what are you most curious about right now?
Right now? There's just so many things. right now, well, it usually is, like, I feel like I have a bunch of stories I'm working on. So I have kind of, I'm juggling different parts of my brain. I'm working on a story about a very rare butterfly. So I've been thinking about that a lot, which is maybe where the bumblebee analogy came from. A butterfly that is super duper rare, and I don't want to spoil the story, but it's like, I just can't stop thinking about this butterfly. I'm also interested in, because the there's a thing that I'm trying to write up for the before the election, which hopefully I'll get it done in time, but it's about, there's this kind of unusual thing that this geologist noticed. It's a pattern that appears, it keeps showing up in the electoral maps from all the recent kind of elections, that corresponds to, uncannily, eerily, something that was forged in the Cretaceous. So if you take these electoral maps and you overlap them with a map of what North America looked like 100 million years ago, there's like one feature that looks exactly the same. And you're like, how is that possible? So that's what I'm doing a story about. It's really cool. It's kind of spooky and kind of funny and interesting and kind of tragic and kind of, but anyway, it's a whole bunch of things. But yeah, but anyway, I feel like I'm just teasing you with stories that I'm working on that I can't tell you about. But anyway, there are a lot of things. I'm usually very curious about very specific things. And it's sort of from the specific, you sort of keep diving in, and then it's there that it like opens up into being something bigger.
Yeah, it's so beautiful. And, you know, we've got a bunch of questions from the audience. And so I'd love to transition to those, because my next question was going to be, what are you working on next? And
okay,
cool. Answered it.
Okay, great.
Yeah. Unless you want to tell me something else.
No, I got a bunch of things I'm working on that I'm really excited about. But yeah, let's just go to audience questions, because okay. That always feels more satisfying.
Amazing, amazing. So one question that comes from Facebook is, do you face burnout when you're pursuing an answer and keep hitting a wall? And how do you overcome that and retain your curiosity?
Yeah, definitely. Yes, for sure. All the time, of course. And in fact, never more so. I did a series earlier this year about this detainee at Guantanamo Bay who shares my name. And covering Guantanamo Bay, there are reporters who do it day in, day out, and more power to them, because I did this one project about this one guy there who, and the you just face constant burnout, because it's like brick walls in every direction. Everything is a brick wall. Every crumb of information, you know, it takes you months to fight for. And even then, it's like, it just leads to other questions. And then you're like, what, now I need to find out more about these. And I, you know, it's going to take me months to figure out even the smallest or remotest answer to any of these questions. It was very frustrating. It was immensely frustrating. And to me, I think the trick to sort of muscling through that is to be buoyed by your own enthusiasm. Let yourself keep remembering how I felt at the beginning of this process when I started, when I was really, when this was a shiny, you know, when this was a really shiny new, this idea still had the new car smell, you know? And it's like, when, like, just keep channeling back to then and trying to sort of stockpile that enthusiasm and energy and endurance and like help you make it through. Sometimes I just quit. Like I feel like it's, if it's that hard and my enthusiasm is not sort of pulling me through, and that enthusiasm is a mixture of like just what I find interesting and also what I find important in the world and what stories need to be told in the world. If it feels like it's like, this is disproportionately hard given how much I want to tell it and how much the world wants to or needs to hear it. If it feels like those, that ratio is out of whack, then it's like, okay, just give up. It's okay. There's no shame in that. Yeah.
So like, but just the idea of failing forward.
Yeah. And it's okay. Like there's no shame in it. And you just think, okay, maybe someone else will do this, or maybe someone else will uncover this and answer it. And then I can just, you know, be happy and read the fruits of their labor. Or pass it on to somebody else to be like, hey, look, and I work on a team. So I also, so much of it is like getting pep talks from my wife, my producers, the teams that I work with who are wonderful people. Or, you know, another thing, this is a really good trick to snap you out of despondency and despair about your own story. Like what I would do, and this is in before times, is like if I was like, just literally find a stranger, whether you're on a bus in before times or you know, taking a rideshare or something, or like, or if you're at an airport waiting in line or something, or like, or now if it's just like you just randomly, you know, meet someone at some Zoom hang, it's a friend of a friend or something. Just meet a stranger and just tell them the story and be like, and hopefully they will be like, wow, I never knew that. That's amazing. And you're like, you're right. It is amazing. And I should keep going with it. So that's also another technique that I feel like it's like, oh yeah, this isn't minutia. Like this is important. And this is going to be surprising to people when I tell them about it.
Yeah.
You just need a reminder of that.
I love that. I'm like literally putting that in my back pocket right now. Constantly annoying my coworkers with this later.
Yeah.
So another question that folks had, and I'm actually very curious about this too, is what does your inbox look like? Oh. Because you shared some wild and unusual topics like medieval robots and the sexual behavior of polar bears.
Yeah.
Can you tell us how listeners and viewers respond to your work?
I'll tell you what my inbox looks like. That I have 18,454 unread emails. Yeah, I know. Cause I like subscribe to a lot of newsletters and stuff, like a lot of newsletters, most of which I don't read, but that are from totally different fields that I like love. And I get so excited about tons of Google alerts and all kinds of weird things. Yeah. It is definitely a horrible. It's a swamp of an email inbox. But in general, how to answer your actual question, how do listeners respond? Mostly positive. Like I think that people are really, really supportive. And I think that it's, I feel like I try to find and tell stories that nobody else is telling or nobody else is interested in, or nobody else really like, yeah, that like feels like a, you know, a thing that maybe, cause to me it's like, that's just more fun. Like there's just so many more stories out there that haven't been told. So I think it's usually like, people who are like, I can't believe you covered this thing I do or I know about or I had some involvement in, and I was always curious about that, but I never thought to, like, that kind of thing. I get that a lot. I get I'm trying to think of if and when I get negative stuff. Like sometimes people correct me. Sometimes I make mistakes all the time. People correct me, and then I try to when I can like correct the story that I do or put out a correction of some kind. But even those, like generally, and I don't know what it is about me, because this is not true in most of the industry, I feel like people are, when they correct me, they're very polite. They're really nice. People are very kind to me. I think that a lot of my, you know, colleagues, like women, queer people, people of color, all kinds of different, people of color, like maybe Black people, Indigenous people, like that kind of thing. Maybe they have it a lot harder than I do, but I'm kind of fortunate, I guess, in a way that most of the people that engage with my work really love it. And they, like, I was so lucky with the thing that was amazing after this show connected, the Netflix show, was there's one of the episodes is about this thing called Benford's Law, which was in the trailer. And people just started emailing me on Twitter and texting me and DMing me and stuff. I applied Benford's Law to this other data set you didn't even do in the show, and it worked there too. And it was like amazing. And to have kind of like, that's the most encouraging thing in the world, to have like listeners and viewers who are like engaged and active and like thinking and like taking the thing that you gave them and like applying it to their lives or their world. And like, that, it's just so inspiring. Like, it makes me want to do better, cooler work that then people, that'll like spur people on further. And especially like when they're kids, like, it's so exciting. Yeah, it's really nice. It's like really, really, really encouraging. The internet has been kind to me.
That's great.
Yeah.
But that's so dope, because I think it actually goes back to what you were saying earlier about how when you sometimes feel like you've hit a brick wall, you have this team, and like, it's not just a relay race with the people that are in your circle. Like, it's this like incredible relay race. Like, even when you haven't hit a brick wall, that I love that your audience can be like, I took this science that you introduced to me and like, I expanded upon it. Now it's bigger than you even thought it was.
Yeah.
And the collaborative nature of that.
It's so cool. And it's like, it makes me feel like, cause that's, I think the spirit that I want, like in a way, my work or the world to sort of feel like, it's like, we're all on the same team here. Like, we're all doing the same thing. And hopefully there's something valuable here that you can take in your work. And like, for example, one of the people who I featured in that Benford's Law episode, as an expert who was using this on stuff, she heard about it because, you know, 10 years before, even before I got there, Radiolab, and I had even forgotten about this, had done a tiny segment about Benford's Law, and she had heard that on the radio and she did a thing about it. Then she became an expert enough in her own field that I went to talk to her about it. Like, so it's like this kind of cyclical thing where you're like, oh, that's cool. Like, I can put this out in the world and like people can pick it up and make of it, you know, and use it in their work, in their lives, in their relationships, or whatever that, you know, feels good for them.
Yeah, that's incredible. And, you know, I think we have time for just one more question, even though I have a million more.
Cool.
But like you said earlier, you can email anybody. So I will be emailing you.
Yeah, no, and seriously, like my personal email is on my website. Like yeah. I'm out there. I got random people emailing me all the time. And I try to respond to, although, as I said, I have 18,454 unread emails in my inbox. But I really try to respond to them. So if there are people out there who want to hit me up, go for it, please. Or better, maybe DMs on Twitter, but whatever. I'll take it anyway.
Use the email, y'all. So last question for you for tonight would be, did working on Connected make you feel more connected to religion in any way?
Yes and no, I think. Like, I think that in a way, I think that, let me see. I mean, there are certain ways in which I feel like my religious identity is one that, like, I feel like I mean, like everybody does in a way, like, especially over the sort of formative years of my life, like, I really struggled over, and I really kind of, you know, and it's one of those things where it's like, it's wrapped up in your relationship with your parents, and you're wrapped up in the country that you live in and the politics that are going on all around you and all of these kinds of things. I feel like that, that part of my identity, like, had been a part that I'd kind of gone over again and again and again to, am I Muslim? To what degree am I Muslim? What does that mean to say that I'm a Muslim? And I think that, So kind of in making this series, I don't think necessarily making Connected made me feel more like a Muslim. I do think, though, like the question we were talking about before, there's a sort of spiritual dimension to the show that I think did sort of, that was important and that was like critical in the development of the show and helped me get through like some personal, you know, hard times. And so I think there's definitely like those bells were ringing in a way. But I don't know necessarily that it made me feel more or less connected to religion. It was just like, ooh, there, like it's ringing those bells, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. That resonates in a lot of ways. Also, I lied to you. There's just one more question that came through that I like really, really, really want the answer
to. Okay, do it.
Okay, great. What podcasts are you listening to right now, or books are you, or what books are you reading right now?
Oh, books, there are a lot. The last book that I fully read, which was really beautiful, but it feels like incestuous that I'm going to say this, but the last book that I read, so it's by Lulu Miller, who's the other, one of the other new co-hosts of Radiolab. She wrote a book called Why Fish Don't Exist, which is really beautiful, and I highly recommend it, but it feels weird to recommend it because it's like a, she's my friend. As for podcasts, there's a bunch that I love and regularly listen to. One I love is called Everything is Alive. Do you know that one?
I do.
Oh, it's so good. It's like interview Terry Gross style or Mark Maron or whoever style interviews with inanimate objects. Yeah. And the objects, like, it's like a can of generic cola or like a chainsaw or like all kinds of different things. And it's like not a joke. Like, it's a serious, where you kind of plumb the emotional depths of what it, would be like to be a Sharpie cap or something, and it's like, oh, wow, this is actually weirdly profound. So I really love that podcast. There are a bunch more. You want more?
It's up to you. You can share one more.
Okay, I'll do one more. There was a podcast. Let me see. There's so many good ones out there.
No problem.
Okay. One that I'm going to say the cheesy thing, but I'm going to say it because I actually, This American Life. It's so good. I do the same thing as they do, basically. And I listen every week and I'm still like, damn, that's still really good. Like, how did they do that? And I say, how did they do that? But I, out of all people, like, I feel like I should know how they did that. But I still am like, how did they do that? I think they just have a tremendous team, and I'm really impressed. But they don't need my props, is the only thing. Like, they're fine. But anyway, whatever. It was just the first thing I could think of. But they actually do deserve, like,
no, it's legit. I remember, I think literally like maybe 8 years ago now, I started working my way through the entire This American Life archive, like
really good,
with breaks like of Beyonce music videos. And it was like a very, very satisfying.
So satisfying.
Well, Latif, this has been such a delight. I'm so, so grateful for your time, for your thoughtfulness, for your honesty and just wisdom and your sense of wonder and curiosity that you brought to this conversation. It was so much fun.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. And I wish you well. And I'm, it's a really hard time for so many people. And I think like just remember that there are beautiful and wondrous and exciting, curious things out there. And it's not all like misery and death and apocalypse. Like, there are still beautiful things out there. And I think that's like a really important thing to remember.
I agree. I can't wait to read about this butterfly or listen about this butterfly, whatever format this comes in. Thank you all so much for joining us, our audience, for the season finale of Pillars Pop-Up Conversations. As you know, every Thursday in October, we are really excited to gather with you on Facebook Live with these incredible Muslim storytellers and story changers to learn more about their work and how we can all work to advance needed social change. Please make sure to sign up for our mailing list at pillarsfund.org and follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram to stay up to date on our events in the future. Have a good one.